Good afternoon, everyone. The title of my talk is The Writing Perspective from a State Regulator. From the very beginning with the interview process, we look at the candidate's writing. So what we do is when the candidate arrives, we sit them down in front of a computer and we give them a technical question. They have 15 minutes to type it out. After that, they go into the interview process. After we have interviewed all the candidates, if we come down to one or two candidates that are very good, but one has a better writing than the other, then the writing example may be the critical issue as to who gets hired. So you can see from the very beginning, we take writing very seriously at the state agencies. Once we've hired a new employee, it's typical that their direct manager or one of the staff members will train the new employee for a period of time. And then once they start working on their own, even after that, the manager will review all their correspondence. Most of the time, these are letters that we're talking about. Obviously, as a new employee, besides the manager, they should reach out to the staff personnel for help. I come from the underground storage tank program, which has a very large volume of communication, both letters and emails that go out between the state agencies and the responsible party or third parties. Because of this, you need to be very careful in both formal letters and emails. Most of the agencies have been around for a long time, so now the different types of letters that we have are templates. And the basic information that goes into a template letter obviously is the date of the letter, who you're writing to, the responsible party typically, their mailing address. You may have the address of the facility that you're reviewing. And most letters are in response to a document that has come to the regulatory agency for review. So you reference that report in your letter. Then also in the letter, who is copied, both internal and external. So internal may be your program manager, may be the commissioner, may be other personnel on the staff. Externally, it'll probably be the consultant that wrote the report, but it may be also third parties such as attorneys, property owners, other real estate owners that may have a voice in the information. And then also who officially signs letters. There may be letters that whoever writes the letter gets to sign, but as more letters are important, other program managers or other people on staff may have to be authorized to sign those letters. Besides the template letters, there are other letters that are more complex that do not fit into a template. These are typically what we call either their comments and suggestions to the report that's been reviewed or actual deficiencies in the report. So when you're writing these type of letters, you need to be very precise in what you're asking for. So the consultant that has written the report understands what you are asking for as to problems that you find or suggestions that you request from the report. And make sure you do not contradict something in the letter. So the cover letter, which would be the template letter, may say, please submit the report within 30 days. But then you have a comment letter, which may have a whole list of things you want them to do. And maybe realistically, 30 days isn't practical. So you need to make sure you don't contradict yourself in your request. The good thing about most letters from state agencies is there is sufficient time after the letter is being written that you can set the letter down, pick it up again, and really sit down and check spelling, grammar, and punctuation. Besides letters and emails that are really the most common communications that a state regulatory agency has, there are other documents, including guidance documents, memos, and standard operating procedures. The guidance documents are typically written procedures on how to conduct an investigation. In our guidance documents, we actually had the template on the actual report that would be submitted as part of that guidance document. Typically, the people that write these are more your senior level staff members. Memos are usually used internally to update upper management as to progress on different types of projects. This is something that I did when I was a program manager. And typically, your more senior level staff members that may be working on special projects will also be writing memos. And then you have standard operating procedures. These can be both internal or external. A couple examples are how to install a monitoring well, how to collect a groundwater sample, sampling rivers and streams. These all would be external. The internal would be the proper routing of a report. So maybe internally you've changed the procedure, and so you update the SOP. Common errors that we see is that each time you write a letter, you should use the template, and cut and paste is a very bad practice to get into. Spell check can be very helpful, but even that can cause errors. You may spell a word that is the correct word grammatically, but it may not be the word you were looking for. So really check and just don't rely on spell check. Also review your noun verb combination. One of the things I do not like is real short, choppy sentences. And then also if you're writing a long letter, be careful in repeating something over and over, using the same phrase over and over again. Try to change it up in your writing. And then if you're, some sites have obviously multiple years of reports coming in and then the agency reviewing it, use the chronological order and make sure you keep things in order. This may be a legal document in the future, so be very careful in laying these out. And then after you're done, please read everything after you think you are complete, because not unusual, you'll still find some little error. Some of the common problems. One of the things I did in this, preparing for this talk, is I contacted one of my former staff members to see what he said about some problems that he had seen. And one of the things he said, do not use the word recommend when you really want the consultant to do the work, that it can be confusing, that it really is a recommendation and not a requirement. You also need to use precise language. What I mean by this, if you're asking the consultant to install a new monitoring well 20 feet northwest of MW1, say it that way, but at the same time, include a map in with your letter. That way they can see exactly where you want them to install additional well or additional sampling. It's not unusual that after you've been with a program for a while, you do a lot of verbal communication with consultants on a daily basis. If you're making agreements on work that needs to be done, obviously follow up with a letter, or if the consultant will take an email, follow up with an email as to what's been agreed to. If the consultant goes back to his office and tells his boss that, yes, we've got approval to do that, obviously his boss is going to say, show me something in writing. So it's very important that you follow up verbal communications in writing. Then what I have is informational comments. And what I mean here is that you may have a report that comes in that's perfect. You've reviewed it and you're writing a letter saying, please continue with the next report. But for some reason, the consultant, maybe the report should have been signed by the responsible party, or maybe once he or she forgot to seal the report by a professional engineer, professional geologist, you may write the bottom of the approval letter, please correct this next time. And obviously show acronyms after words are written out. So I came from the underground storage tank program, so you put UST in parentheses. This is very important because you do have a lot of people that will review this letter besides the RP and the consultant. That would include lawyers that may not be familiar with environmental issues, or property owners or real estate owners. So it's real important to explain it to them. Email issues, obviously they have the same issues that you have with letters. Again, you need to be careful and write precise sentences. I say don't use slang because it may mean different things to different people. If you're replying to a question, answer the question and then end it. Don't jump around different subjects. You don't know who, when you reply to this email, who they may pass it on to, so just answer the question. Again, I wrote, don't try to be cute or funny, because these are considered legal documents. Many years ago, I was in federal court and they blew up one of my letters to 6 feet tall for the jury to see. This could happen through an email also. So take these very seriously. I've got a couple different examples of letters. I know these are small, a little hard to read, but on the left side would be the template part of the letter. And you can see that it has the date at the top. Then the address goes to the RP, followed by under subject, the location of the facility. And you can see in the first paragraph, it says that the consultant's letter dated February 17, 2017, they submitted a monitor only report. Then I replied, please submit the next semi-annual monitoring report by September 1st, 2017. I signed the letter. Then at the very bottom, it has that I copied the ICC, the professional geologist that sealed this report. On the right-hand side is just an example of what I consider just where there is no template, and I'm asking the recurrence of free product needs to be evaluated. And it goes on further. So that's an example of just be very clear as to what you're asking for. Here's another example of a template, and this is a no further action template. Again, it has the date at the top, the responsible party of who I'm writing to, the location of the facility, and they submitted a report dated March 28, 2017, and it was a progress report. And then the second paragraph has it, I'm giving no further actions required for the reference release. The third paragraph is standard writing that we have in all no further action letters. Then the last paragraph, I say, please submit a completion report. And by June 15th of 2017, again, I sign it. At the very bottom, again, I CC the professional geologist that sealed the report to me. And how do you improve it? So if you work for a regulatory agency, obviously reach out to your manager and staff. They've written and reviewed literally hundreds of letters that they can help you. You can also ask for letters. These are typically on your server where you can pull up other people's letters or go to the file room to review letters. There's lots of books and online help when it comes to writing. The one book that I used was the Elements of Style. This is very helpful for me. For students still in college, I recommend take a technical writing class. I did this when I was an undergraduate. Also, more and more of the classes, even in geology, require written reports. So really take these seriously. The more writing you do, the better you'll become. Do a senior thesis project that does require a written report. It's very helpful. And also reach out to your professors for help. If you're really having problems, they will help you. Thank you very much.